The Boca Raton Museum of Art to receive me at Arts at Work and give me this opportunity to present part of my work as an artist. Also my thanks to Run Art Foundry for the support with the material I have here today and will present today. This presentation is dedicated to all people that has interest in the art of the sculpture in bronze and has no opportunity to follow close all the steps in a foundry. My name is Noemia Felipe. I am from Brazil, and I moved to the United States in 2005. Today I'm here to present to you a summary of my biography and talk about the work of figurative sculpture from modeling in oil-based clay and armature and show the step-by-step of the figurative sculpture in lost wax casting. The objects you see on the table, they are part of the process since their work by the sculpture with the oil-based clay and the armature up to the step-by-step in a foundry, and some pieces really you just see in a foundry during the process. They are original pieces from my own sculptures. At the end of my presentation, you are all invited to come to the table and look close all the pieces. The idea to give a presentation of a process for a bronze came from the question I have heard most. How do you sculpt the bronze? It's not too hard to carve. So I don't sculpt the bronze, I don't carve the bronze. It's a long process that I will show you today. My career as an artist starts in the second year of the college when I got my first private commission. I attended the Fine Arts College in Brazil in 1986, I'm not so old, so it's 1986, and I graduated with a Bachelor of Arts in Painting. Since then, I have been working with commissions of portraits and landscapes in oil and canvas, watercolor and pastels. When I moved to the United States, my goal was to improve my sculpture skills. So in 2009, I started the master studio classes at Boca Raton Museum of Art, the Art School, under Miles Loventhal. At the master studio, I have been working in paintings, terracotta, mixed media, and sculpture in oil-based clay with finishing in bronze. After the college, I have worked with enamel on porcelain in the styles Japanese, Chinese, Huan, and Delft. With the time, I have created my own approach in Art Nouveau style. Inspired on a brooch by René Lalique called Dragonfly, I developed this piece. And inspired by Lalique's brooch, I applied zircons on top of gold rings that represents the diamonds from the original brooch. In 1998, I was awarded with this piece. Then, in 2 years, I developed 23 pieces that was part of my solo exhibition in São Paulo in 2000. The show was a huge success, and I sold 70% of the pieces during the opening. Here is one of the remaining pieces of that time. It calls Lilies of the Vale and has pearls, gold rings, and the green agate stones. This shows two of my paintings. Is Passo Doble, is acrylic on canvas, and Autumn Light is acrylic on canvas, dry leaves in a wood panel. Here, three of my paintings in acrylic and oil on canvas. And I like this series because this series shows my connection with the sea. Is Whispers of the Sea, Feeling is All, and Water and Soul. Here is an installation. It calls The Five Muses. It's an installation with five faces sculpted in terracotta and finishing in acrylic paint on wood panel. They represent the five arts that have been influenced my art, and they are painting, music, sculpture, poetry, and philosophy. So those are the five muses that inspire my work. Here a close-up of the sculpture muse, and beside is the garden angel. It's a sculpture in terracotta with finishing acrylic paint and palm tree barks. The angel, he carries the little soul on his hand, protecting her. This is my last figurative mixed media sculpture, Free as the Wind. I have sculpted with wire and paper clay. Paper clay is a kind of papier-mâché, and that is paper mixed with clay. Also, as part of the sculpture, tree branches and real dried leaves. So this is a sample of my mixed media in sculpture, and all figurative. Here one of my sculptures in bronze, Brazilian Tango. It represents the dance of life, the dance of love between a couple, and the piano strings represents the music. Another sculpture in bronze, Key to Perfection. It means she's tired, the big one. Let's see, that's my point here. She's tired and she has a padlock on her hand. And the small figure, he has a key. The padlock means the knowledge that he wants to reach. And the small figure, she's trying to reach the key that will open the padlock. I consider this as a self-portrait and is myself doing all my path as artist. And even sometimes if I feel very tired, I never gave up in order to follow, to reach my goals as artist. And the male figure on the top represents the other people have passed on my life and that have supported me as artist. As my father and my mentors in Brazil and here in US. So here we start to see something about the oil-based clay and armature. This sculpture is, I call, the eternal walk, and is about the time. This sculpture is not cast in bronze yet. It looks the way you see here. She's the time. The big figure is the time, and her long legs, she has large steps. And the young boy represents the beginning of everything in life. Why to choose the oil-based clay and not water-based clay with armature? When we work with sculpture, one of the main concerns is about collapsing. So water-based clay is perfect for a finished work, and this approach demands a special technique because it will be fired in a kiln. Also, the water-based clay dries and shrinks. It has a structure, if it has a structure in wood inside of the water-based clay, the clay will dry and crack. The oil-based clay never dries. So there is no concern about shrink and cracks. The sculptor can move and change the design how many times he wants. As I will show you, I have here a work in progress on the table. It's the first sculpture. And I will show you that I can move all the arms, I can move the head, I can change the design how many times I want. Because inside of the figure, there is a structure in wire, and this wire works as a skeleton and supports the weight of the clay. Also, the armature supports the weight of the clay and avoid collapsing. These two figures, is a couple, they are embracing each other, and my idea is, when I had the concept for embracing couple, I thought how I will sculpt the parts that they are joined together. It would be too difficult. So this is the reason I create two separate armatures. Then I can work in front of them first, and then bring them together and work outside. I would like to tell you that this is a work in progress, so the concept is there, it's an embracing couple. But as a design, I can change anything I want, okay? I will give some fast demonstration, okay? With no microphone. So, this is what I have here, some clay. If someone doesn't know and would like to try, is oil-based clay, the one that never dries. And the way it works, just add the clay. I work most of the time with my fingers. They are my best tools as a sculptor. So here is the leg. And I also work with the traditional sculpture tools. In any place it's necessary to take and model all the clay. As here on the back, I first start this work thinking to have the back and the head hollow. It was a first design, but now I changed my mind. So I can change my mind anytime I want in order to have the approach for the design. This I will leave here. And you can see, because there is the structure inside in wire, I can move his head with no concern it will crack. So I can put you cannot see, but I will move her head this side, and here you kiss her cheek, or they will kiss in the lips, or in the, so, and anything. And the arms also, I can move the arms. So she's embracing him. Anything. So I want you to know what is the concerns of the sculpture when we are bring the concept from our mind to this real world. So it's an issue to work here, and I want this looks more believable as possible. So what I do I created these two armatures. Then I opened the arms. And then I release her. Okay? So this way I can work on him here in all the front. I can work on her and then just place them together and I will have the complete design. Also, this will make it easier for the foundry. When they are together, this will make it easy for the foundry to follow all the steps that you see with the mold and wax and everything, okay? Are you being able to listen to me without the microphone?
Yes.
Oh, great. I need to tell you that it's possible to have a casting bronze in any shape, in any media. You saw before my Brazilian tango and key to perfection. They were made, the original sculptures, they were made in terracotta. But as you can see, the first picture I'm working in key to perfection, and this, the beside I am working with the piano strings, placing the piano strings on the terracotta sculpture, the original one. But those designs, they are more compact. So they were able to be fired and become a terracotta, and I have the original pieces with me in my collection, and then it was able to have this piece in bronze as well. For today, I have bringing my series Dance of the Hours. It's on the table. They are the three blue bronze sculptures you see on the table. And they the series consists in three figures, three sculptures. It's the sunrise, noon, and sunset. They are the hours of the day. The noon is the tallest one with the sun, and then the sunrise is a little shorter, and the sunset is the shortest one. Here I am working at the beginning when I decided to create this series, the three figures together. I am working creating the armature and the structure with pliers and wire and pipes. Here I am working in the three sculptures together, modeling with oil-based clay. This series I worked with the three figures at the same time, the three sculptures at the same time. Here is interesting, I think it's interesting to know that the work, the use of armature is not new. It's an ancient technique, and here is one of the samples I brought to show you. This is one of the angels by Bernini, and is in St. Peter in Vatican. And we are lucky this model has survived, and we can see how he have worked with. He have mixed the pieces of the wood, straws and wire, as you can see on the wings. At the time, didn't exist the oil-based clay. The oil-based clay just started in Europe in 1880. So he had used the water-based clay, but he probably had mixed horsehair on the water-based clay in order to try the clay more resistant to collapsing. But again, working with water-based clay on armature never can be fired. Never will be a final work, never will be fired. And sooner or later, as you can see here on this sample, the model by Bernini, parts of the clay will fall apart. And beside you can see the finished work in bronze that is in Vatican. My Dance of the Hours had as reference photos that I took of a friend of mine in Brazil. She's a dancer, and I gave her a scarf, and I told her, please keep dancing, and I was just taking pictures of her while she was moving. And these photos were my reference and my inspiration for these sculptures. The oil-based clay is a mixing of oil, wax, and clay minerals. And because it never dries, it can be reused. You don't lose the clay. You can reuse for another for another sculpture, for another project. Here, the sculpture is ready to bring to the foundry. The first step on the foundry is the mold. Figurative sculpture, complex as mine, needs to cut the original sculpture and make more than one mold. This one you see here is Noon, that you see on the table is the middle blue sculpture in bronze. But what you see here on the picture is my original work that I have delivered to the foundry in oil-based clay and the armature. Noon has two molds, one with the scarf and the hands, and another mold for the body. And here we start to talk about the process in the foundry. I think it's important an artist, an sculptor that intends to have a work in bronze, to know the process and follow almost all the steps in the foundry, because the artist, the sculptor, he is responsible for the results at the end. So when you are working with a foundry, you deliver the original work sculpted in oil-based clay, and you'll be there discussing about the mold, where the parts of the mold, the figure, the sculpture will be cut for each piece for the mold, and you go there to see the wax, if the finishing was doing well, because the final work in bronze will look exactly like the wax, the copy, the piece in wax. And also be there to talking and working together with the professional in the foundry about the patina. Is the artist who needs to know the color he wants and explain more detail is possible, where will be the shadows, where will be the lights, and what kind of color we want. So I could say it's a collaborative work between the sculpture and the foundry. Here you see some famous samples, Rodin, Camille Claudel. Here is in green is an ancient Greek sculpture, and this patina is made by the time and is impossible to reach. I have tried and I never reached. Could not get. I asked this patina, I brought this color of the patina to the foundry, and the lady, she looks to me, this is impossible. Unless you live for centuries on the weather and on the sea. And so, and patina is about to, the reference for patina are really the original patinas from the time. Is a great inspiration. What we look for, now is more contemporary, but what we're looking for when we are doing a sculpture in bronze, we have the nature as reference. In a foundry, all the professionals are artists. Each one is responsible for one of the steps. The mold is made in several layers of rubber. Here you can see the professional is applying the first layer of rubber. And a wall in clay is constructed. Let's see if I can show you. This is a wall in clay that he has placed all around. He wants to fulfill with the rubber. After he does this first part of the mold, he will take this wall in clay and work in the other side of the mold with the rubber. Keys, we call this as keys. All these half spheres, usually the shape is a half sphere in positive and negative. And here you can see is the Noon sculpture, that is the middle one we have on the table. And you cannot see, her arm was cut and the scarf was taken with her arm. Why? Because this piece has two molds, one for the body and another one for the scarf. These keys are made to, in order to make both parts of the mold, the rubber, very stable. the half spheres, they match to each other, and when they are together, they will be very stable to receive the wax. Here you see the two parts of the mold for the body of the gnome. And because the rubber is very malleable, needs to have a covering plaster, that is usually plaster or fiberglass. The mold that I brought today has the cover in fiberglass. And this cover will support the rubber. Here a close-up of the keys. And on the table, I have one of the molds open that you'll be able to see what I'm talking about. As you can see, this is the way I received it from the foundry after it was made the mold. Why I brought this piece today? Because I want to show that the original work that the sculptor does never will be the final work, and we cannot be attached. We need to take pictures, we need to know our sculptor like it was our child, because everything, this piece is this one. Is this figure, okay? So this works as a reference. And here you can see, I have showed you that she was cut in the arm. And you can see when you come close to the table, you'll be able to see the armature that exists inside of her. And also all the marks that were made by the foundry in order to create the two parts for the mold, okay? All these pieces we have here, 1, 2, 3, 4 molds. It's just for one sculpture. And it's those molds, they are original for my piece that is this one, Sunrise. I left one open, and you'll be able to see when you come here. You see, usually it's a half sphere, the keys, but this one, the foundry made straight as. And this will be placed together, and with screws will be very stable to receive the wax. See how malleable? So let's see. Here I have. Here, this one has, here it was where this mold have received the melted wax, okay? And this one, when she was closing, it was from here. And you still can see some remaining wax here that is red. A detail about the oil-based clay. The oil-based clay not necessarily is gray. There are oil-based clay in white, in black, dark gray, white gray, and also in terracotta color. So the artist can choose the color that feels better to work with. Also, the mold is ready. Molten wax is poured into the mold. 3 coats of wax is necessary to reach the thickness of the piece. The piece in bronze will have the same appearance of the piece in wax. So here he is pouring the melted wax inside the mold. And then he will take it out the excess and create a layer, the first layer, and then another coat, and then another coat until to the thickness that he wants for the final wax that will be the same thickness of the bronze. This image shows the body of a gnome that you already know, right? It's the middle one. The bronze sculpture in blue you see on the table is the gnome. And these images show her body inside of the mold. On this case of this series, the wax is compact, is not hollow. And the bronze you see here, they are also compact because it's too thin. So we decide to make compact. But when the piece is large, then the wax will be hollow. I brought you to show you the wax of one of my sculptures, that is the sunrise, the same of the mold. And I brought also a small sculpture in bronze, it was made in Brazil, and I called the Little Mermaid. The Little Mermaid you see is hollow, so also the wax was also hollow. So, are you being able to follow all the steps? We are the sculptor that have had the concept, create a structure for the concept, then work with the clay. Then we brought the sculpture to the foundry. The foundry did the mold. From the mold, they did the wax. From this mold, they did the wax. And it's the same mold. This mold is for this figure, and this figure is this sculpture. So you can see what you have in wax will be what you have in bronze. This is, I think, is important that the artists follow the steps with the professionals on the foundry. And we are always very welcome. It's really a collaborative work between the artist and the foundry. So it'll be here to you to see later. And this is my little mermaid. She was made in Brazil. And this patina is the most classic, most popular patina. It's the brown patina. And you can see she's hollow. So this is what I'm talking about. And you see on the image that he was pouring the wax and pouring back and creating a layer of wax that will be the thickness of the bronze. After take the wax from the mold, then a professional, he will rub out all the marks and imperfections on the wax with metal tools heated. And this is what you see here. For each bronze, it's necessary a piece of wax. Why? Because from each piece in wax, we'll be making another mold called hard shell or ceramic shell. This hard shell will be placed in a kiln, and the wax will be melted. The space inside the hard shell is the shape of the sculpture, and it's inside this space in the hard shell that will receive the molten bronze. The sculptures will be numbered 3 artist proof, AP, and up to 9 pieces, 1 of 9 up to 9 of 9. 12 pieces is the maximum for a consider to be unique. So just it. If it's more than 12 pieces and needs to be 3 AP and 9 pieces, if it's more, then it's industrial. After the collection is done, the original molding rubber will be destroyed in order to avoid replicating the piece. So if I order all the 12 pieces for my Dance of the Hour series, the original mold that you see there will be destroyed in order to save the fact that it will be unique. The piece in wax is mounted in a tree-like structure with strips in wax that you see here is in red. These strips will provide paths for the molding bronze to flow and for air to escape. The piece in wax will receive coats of slurry upside down. At the top, you can see that side is upside down, and on the top you see a funnel. All in wax. This is all in wax yet. And from that funnel, that will receive the bronze on the hard shell. Here is a sample of a sculpture receiving a coat of the slurry. It's a slurry of silica, and then will be with crystalline silica as well. Dry crystalline silica, sorry. The slurry and the grit combination is called ceramic shell or hard shell. The process is repeated until at least 1/2 inch coating covers the entire piece, around 9 coats. So a piece in wax will receive around 9 coats of slurry up to have this appearance. That is the hard shell. It's not hard yet, but it will be. And I have here, I brought, this is a kind of step that you just see in the foundry, the wax and the ceramic shell. I brought here and I will show you there. This is how the hard shell looks like. In fact, it's together. This is one piece, okay? And we will be, when receive, this is the piece that will receive the molten bronze. Will be upside down. Will be this way, with this part on the top, okay? The foundry have cut for me in two pieces because you'll be able where the molten bronze will run inside of this ceramic shell. So the wax that you see here, there was one inside of this one, is the same. But here is already with no wax. The ceramic shell is placed in a kiln, and the heat will harden the coatings into a shell. The wax will be melt and runs out. This is the reason it calls lost wax, and this is the reason we need one wax for each piece in bronze, because each one will have a hard shell, and each one, the wax will be lost, okay? The melted wax can be recovered and reused. The metal, in general bronze, is a combination of copper and tin or aluminum, and is melted in a crucible, in a furnace, and then poured carefully into the shell. The shell needs to be hot, otherwise the difference of temperature would crack it. So here you can see the first image is taken from the crucible and then pouring inside the hard shell, upside down. Here another detail. And I can tell you it's very hot. I have been there once and I was able to watch, and it's wonderful to see people working so carefully. And it's a hard work and it's really very, very hot. The ceramic shell then is hammered, releasing the rough casting. The casting will be cleaned and fixed all the imperfections. The structure for air to escape will be removed. The tree-like, remember I told you about the tree-like structure? This one has here, and here was the funnel, here was the funnel. This will be taken, he will be clean, and then all the parts that are separate at this time will be welded and be polished. The bronze is finally ready to receive the patina. Here is my work, is known. And here is the bronze piece with the same shape you saw in wax, with the tree-like and all the paths for the air, and the bronze runs out. And you see the legs are behind her. They were casting bronze together all in one piece. So it was released and then welded and then cleaned and then polished everything. On this image, you see she's ready to receive the patina. The patina is made with acids and fire. And the most traditional is the brown and the green. In the dance of flowers, I have chosen the blue patina that you see here in the collection, is here. And after the patina, a coat of wax is applied for protection. And I love this. I was there talking with Mr. Rudis Lopez. He's the owner of the Art Foundry that have did all the step to me, and I was all the time following the color, the how I wanted the blue, where I wanted the lights and the everything. And here she's done, and she's really here to you all to take a look close. And I appreciate very much your time, And I hope from now you can look to a figurative sculpture in bronze in galleries and museums, in special here in the Boca Raton Museum of Art. We have a beautiful collection in the sculpture garden, and you have a strong connection imagining how the artists have achieved the vision and delivered a very special piece of art to the society, to us. And I would like to finish this presentation with a quote by a French sculptor, Antoine Bourdelle, is one that I like very much. And I have as a principle of my art as well, and if it was enough to him, it's enough to me. And he used to say, the secret of art is love. So now you are all invited to come close to the table, and there is a guest book when you leave. If you leave your comments, I will appreciate. Thank you very much. The piece is done in clay and bring to the foundry. It can take between 2 months and 8 months. Wow. It depends how busy is the foundry and in the line you are, and also it depends the how complex is the figure. Like mine is very complex because it's very teeny, it's detailed, is very realistic. So there is the eyes, there is the nose, the lips, and the ears, and the fingers. When a foundry works in a huge, like if you bring a piece of head, that the eye is this size, it's much easier. Even to the sculptor, sculpt an eye of this size, that sculptor an eye of this size. So it's the time that they take. And for the experience I have, took 2 months up to 8 months. Wow. So each one of these took around 8 months.
Wow. Mimi, how many, do you typically do the full run of 9 or do you keep yours more limited?
Excuse me?
Do you typically do the full run of 9?
No, it's very expensive. So for you have an idea, I did each one of these pieces in 1 year. I order one, then I order two, then I order two. Of course, if you have a commission, then we will be faster. But for the artists like me, I usually work with more than one work at the same time. And I usually work in different mediums at the same time. I try to work with the same medium. So 3 sculptures in oil-based clay and armature. Okay, you'll be fine. I guess I have answered your question.
Yes.
So if you have no questions, you can come close and take a look on the table. You have time yet?
It's not a question, but you really are so accomplished with the armatures that you did that yourself.
Yes, as I showed the pictures, it's me working, yes.